marketing. But still, Islam was his whole life. He went to one of their meetings. It was a big meeting, 20,000 people. And he was told if he goes to the first meeting, he'll be in the front row for the second meeting with these top experts in network marketing. So he says, I'll do it. He didn't know it was a church service. And then he came to his senses. He says, oh, I see what they're doing. They're using this network marketing to market Jesus. I'm gonna observe what they do, and I'll do the same thing for Islam. And so he goes to his third meeting like this, and they say, stand up to accept Jesus as their Messiah. And he stands up out of respect, and all of a sudden, Faisal, the last thing in the world you expected, what happened?
Well, suddenly God showed up. I didn't know this was even possible. And I remember standing there and his presence went right through me, went right around me. I was completely surrounded with the presence of God. And I had all these questions going through my heart and mind, like, what is going on? How is this possible? First of all, I didn't understand why God would even manifest amongst the people that I thought were blaspheming him by worshiping Jesus. And so this is going through me and I'm in his presence and all these questions are disappearing except one question that was burning in my heart. And I said, God, what are you doing here? I thought these are the bad guys, meaning the Christians. And then I heard an audible voice and he said, no, these are my children. And he said it again, no, these are my children. And a third time, no, these are my children. And when he said that, it was like everything I'd experienced as a Muslim, all that I'd ever known about God, immediately was gone. And I was only conscious of one reality, that Jesus, you are the Son of God.
Okay, let me take you now to February 24th. You experienced the river of God's love. Tell me about that.
I never knew God could actually come in to see an individual. I always thought he showed up in large crowds like that meeting. And so here I was at 7:30 in the morning, the tangible presence of God, the reality of God just began to fill that entire basement of a basement I was living in. And it got stronger and stronger and stronger. And I sensed a tangible river go right through my being. It was nonstop, like, you know how a river, a waterfall, just flowing like so powerfully. But it's love, it was life, it was substance. It was something I'd never experienced, and it's going right through me nonstop for 3 hours. And I remember hearing this beautiful, audible, yet authoritative voice. And this was the voice of our Father, Father God. And he said, I love you, son. I love you, son. I love you, son, three times.
Yeah, but you must have known that within Islam.
No, actually, all my life, Sid, I never heard those words growing up as a Muslim. I never remember hearing the words, I love you. I remember hearing, I wish you weren't born. I remember hearing things like that. But something in those words, when he said, I love you, son, that began to do something to me. I didn't even know how to respond except by saying, I love you, Father. I love you, Father. It was this exchange of supernatural love in the form of a river tangibly. And all I can tell you is the fruit of it. Three things happened as a result. Number one, I had a love and an intense hunger for the Father. I had a love for God I didn't have up till that point in my life. Number two, I had more love for people. You know, we're all growing in love. So I suddenly sensed I love people more than I did up till that moment. And the third thing was, I had a love and a hunger intensely for the Word of God. And I remember picking up the Bible, and for 36 hours, supernaturally, I read through the entire Bible. I couldn't eat anything. I could only digest the Word of God. And it was supernatural in that when I would look at the page of the Bible, literally a page or a passage at a time, would almost lift off the page, go inside of my spirit, and I understood what it was saying. I knew exactly what was happening. I didn't know what to call it, but that was revelation. That God began to write His Word upon my heart. And I began to have a revelation of God's realities, His truth, and began to apply them in my life.
Faisal, tell me about Camille.
By the age of 5, he was already dreaming about killing infidels, Israelites, and Americans. At the age of 7, he joined the PLO, and they taught him how to use an AK-47, and he started his terrorist career. And he started training children and taking them into the Golan Heights in Israel and, you know, smuggling ammunition and TNT and bombs and explosives to have, you know, bomb threats and killings to go on. That's what he was doing at that young age, and that was his passion. That's how he grew up. And it's absolutely amazing through the journey how God really touched him.
But he was involved in a horrible automobile accident. And a doctor felt sorry for him because he was now in America. He came to America to win as many people to Islam as possible. And by the way, I found it interesting. They use women. Yes. To win.
Yeah. Kamal explained how he was trying to commit what they call cultural jihad. So he'd come to America and he's, you know, they find women to marry so they could get their citizenship or resident cards or whatever they needed, and they would spread Islam through their families. And this is the kind of journey he was on. He would also visit the poor. He'd also meet African Americans. These are all part of their strategies through which they felt to spread Islam. And then he had this accident that you referred to, and it was absolutely...
Right. Well, this doctor... took a liking to him. I mean, the guy is there, really. He hates everyone. But they took a liking to him. They took him into their home with their children. And the children just, he couldn't handle it. The children loved him. They love-bombed him. Let's go to him speaking in his own words.
And now, these little kids put their little hand on me and started doing the Jesus prayer. I was trained to fight anything in life. Take down any big giant. But those little loving hand that laid, touched my hand, melted my heart. There was a war inside of me. These men would come once a week, will make a hole, will make a circle around me, and they put me in the middle and they pray that God may heal me, that God may bless me, that God may light shine his face upon me, that God can bless me, and they're doing this in the name of Jesus. Now I came to this understanding that these people are not the bad people that I thought that they are. Allah, these people have relationship with their God. I want to have relationship with you too. I want to hear you saying that you love me. I want to know you, if you are real, speak to me. Now bear in mind, these men and women, they pray for healing and receive healing. They pray for breakthrough, they receive breakthrough. They pray and ask, and I hear them saying, I heard God said this and this. I'm going, I want to have that relationship. If this is real, I want to have it, because I've been worshiping Allah all days of my life and I earned it.
You know, Kamal got so frustrated because his God wouldn't love him like these Christians had the love. His God wouldn't even speak to him. Nothing. So he got so desperate, he decides to commit suicide. What happened next?
Well, he pulls out his gun and he's getting ready to shoot himself, and he hears this voice. And the voice says very gently, Kamal, Muslims worship the God of Abraham and pray to him. Jews pray to the God of Abraham. And Christians pray to the God of Abraham. Why don't you pray and call on the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? So he said, okay, well, this, let me give this a try. So he says, oh, God of Abraham, if you are real, show yourself, reveal yourself to me. And suddenly, this light began to fill his room. This glory, he says, come into the room. And Jesus walked right into the room. And he said, who are you, Lord? Kind of like Paul said. And he heard Jesus say to him, I am that I am. And he says, what is that supposed to mean? He says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And that is where he got so touched by Jesus, he got instantly healed. His neck, his collarbone, his bones.
He was so severe that he couldn't function himself.
He could not, but instantly he was healed. Huh. And he felt this liquid fire and love go through him. And he was supernaturally healed at that very moment.
Now, Khalida is a Palestinian Arab. And I have never heard, I don't know how you survived, Khalida. I mean, and you have a smile on your face, but let me tell you a little bit about Khalida. When she was 11 days old, her mother died, her father abandoned her, and she was put into an orphanage. And she stayed in this orphanage till age 9. She went out to get some water to drink, and a bomb hits the orphanage, and her whole new family wiped out. And then somehow they didn't know what to do with her. And you're just 9 years old and they sell you as a slave to Bedouins. And you were worse than a slave. They would beat you. The only food you had was leftovers. And the soldiers finally rescued you. And they put you in another orphanage, and then they found your natural father, but he didn't want you. I mean, rejection, rejection, rejection. How much rejection can a human take? I mean, I don't know how a human can have that much rejection. And then your father makes you a slave. He doesn't want you. And at age 15, he forces her into a marriage. The husband, after a while and after a child, kicks her out, divorces her, horrible shame. Her father still wants to get rid of her. So he gets rid of your only child, and he marries you off again to a man. You go to the United States, and this man, I mean, according to my notes here, he broke your jaw. Why did he do that?
Well, he was an angry man, and he was my husband. And in Islam, they teach men that they need to correct their wives. So he was just giving me a good lesson, and it was very good to break my jaw. Mm. I didn't learn anything, by the way.
I'm sure. Okay, so you have three children. You're married to an abusive husband again. I don't get it. How could you take all of this? Not just him. Your whole life. How did you do it?
Well, I was going crazy. You know, before the Lord, I was going crazy, but the grace of God.
Then it gets worse. He lets her know he's going to kill her. What did you do about that?
I needed to run away. I needed to run for my life. Yeah, I was.
You actually heard a voice.
I heard a voice. I remember, like I told you, trying to kill myself before I heard that voice. And then I heard an audible voice saying to me, "Leave the darkness into the light." Now I thought I'm going crazy anyway, but might as well, I'll follow that voice. I'm not gonna lose anything
I lost. But what does a woman do that doesn't speak English, doesn't have money, and has three small children wandering the streets? What happened to you?
I met a Christian lady that took me in as her own daughter and told me about the love of Jesus.
But you loved Islam. You really did love Islam.
I did.
So you loved this woman for what she did for you,
right?
But you didn't want her Jesus.
Exactly. And my conflict was always how God, you know, how can I believe that God have a son? Because they taught us in Islam that God cannot be weak and have a son. That's a sign of weakness. So I struggled with that. I wanted to have the love that woman had, and that was the breaking point. I saw her joy, I saw her love, I saw her life being symbol, but she was always connecting to God, and I was hungry for that.
And then you decide, this is the moment, I want to know the truth. Tell me what your prayer was and what happened.
I remember feeling sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I remember praying, asking Jesus, if you really who you are, what people say you are, because I didn't know if it's true or not, really. If people say that you are the Son of God, then show me. Then come to me and show me that you are the Son of God. And I didn't think anything was going to happen out of that prayer. But the result of that simple prayer was Jesus appearing to me and having an encounter with the Lord in the supernatural.
That would have been enough. But then she goes on to heaven. What did you see in heaven?
I saw the worship. I saw how much heaven adores Jesus as the Son of God, exalts him as a king. Some of the things I saw, that babies, people, beings were throwing a crown at the feet of Jesus. He was strong and majestic.
You didn't know this was in the Bible?
I didn't know. I never read the Bible before I had that experience. All I knew is what I'm seeing have to be real because it was so vivid and it was so real, and I became part of heaven. There is no way you could deny it. One thing in heaven is Jesus is the Word of God, and as you look upon His face and His light and His glory, revelation becomes so vivid and so real, you cannot escape it.